Jalassi, bienvenue, welcome to Cape Breton Highlands National Park. Cape Breton Highlands National Park encompasses approximately 950 square kilometers of wilderness, located on Cape Breton Island or Unamagi, the ancestral and unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq. A third of the world-famous Cabot Trail winds through the Cape Breton Highlands National Park, a 298-kilometer highway which connects the communities of northern Cape Breton and provides visitors access to local amenities and, of course, natural wonders. Although this geographic region offers spectacular scenery, wildlife, and culture, at times, its climate can be unforgiving. Climate change is one of the greatest challenges of our generation and impacts the integrity of natural and built resources found in the park. Scientists predict that global climate change will likely create warmer, drier summers, warm winters, and increased precipitation in northern Cape Breton. In late November 2021, the park experienced a severe weather event with higher than normal temperatures and a heavy amount of rainfall over a short period of time. This resulted in significant damages to infrastructure, including culvert failures and road washouts on segments of the Cabot Trail between Inganish and Neal's Harbor. Additionally, raging floodwaters from the storm impacted both aquatic and terrestrial ecosystems found in Cape Breton Highlands National Park. The storm damage was so severe that a 15-kilometer stretch of the Cabot Trail was deemed impassable. Because this route connects northern communities to the rest of Cape Breton, many residents north of Inganish became isolated from resources. Climate change impacts to Parks Canada-administered places are complex, and the agency is already integrating climate change mitigation and adaptation actions into our work. This includes restoration of important infrastructure, such as highways and waterways, while protecting ecosystems, staff, and local communities.
We had about 270 millimeters of rain in a 24-hour period, and with that, there was a lot of, obviously, rain that fell on the catchment area of the Inganish Beach and the Inganish Broad Cove area, and there was multiple failures of highway structures from Inganish Ferry all the way up to Neal's Harbor, and even beyond up into Effie's Brook. You know, I think I described it as, you know, waist-deep water with 200-pound boulders getting strewn about. So it was a real torrent down in that area. The team had made the call to sort of, you know, close the road, and Davey was part of that, closing the road, working his way back towards Inganish. Things got real for us when Davey found into some trouble when he hit the washout at Little Smoky. So that really brought home how serious it was.
During the November storm, a Parks Canada staff member patrolling the highway was caught in a road washout. Thankfully, this team member did not suffer any severe injuries.
I called out on patrol that Tuesday night for the heavy rain, checking drains, you know, washouts and stuff like that. And I was heading back, and the first thing I knew, I was down in a washout. I always say between 12 and 15 feet below. Well, I got out. By the time that the EMT came, the truck was gone, had washed out towards the Broad Cove there.
Usually we're used for it coming from the surge from the ocean, but this time it wasn't the ocean, it was coming out of the mountains, and I guess the speed that it came out of the mountains was probably the biggest impact. A lot of people still on the roads, and that was one of our main concerns, and I guess after the incident that happened within the national park with the road collapsing, kind of we had to ramp things up and get people off the road, and we actually ended up declaring a state of emergency for Victoria County.
The highway obviously is the lifeline for schools, for hospitals, for health care, home care. It's the number one priority for not only this field unit, but for northern Cape Breton, so it was our number one priority. The team really sprung into action. It was a real all hands on deck sort of scene, so we had to immediately spool up and get contractors on site, contracting involved, consultants. We had visual inspections, we had divers, we had, you know, structural assessments of that, plus also all the culverts between Neal's Harbor and Inganish Beach. At the same time, we also had noticed three additional spots where there were large sinkholes under the highway that from the top, you know, you can see asphalt is intact, but underneath there's large cavities that were ready to go at any moment.
We plan for this. The municipality has an emergency plan, and we review it all the time. And anytime you have a disaster or an emergency, it certainly opens the door to making discussions that you never had before. Something that we've never had in our emergency plan was being able to helicopter in essential staff, like hospital staff, nurses, doctors, paramedics, and we made that happen.
Parks Canada team members monitor assets on a daily basis and conduct investigations following storms.
The big problem with a storm like that is the scale and, unfortunately in this case, also the timing. Because of the timing and the scale of that storm, we lost a whole generation of salmon. It was really an unfortunate thing that it happened, but I feel like it also demonstrates the importance of programs like ours and the work that we do to try to protect and recover ecosystems.
Visitor experience may also be affected by higher average temperatures in the park. The effects of climate change on visitor experience may include increased prevalence of climate and weather-related medical emergencies, such as heat exhaustion, heat stroke, and dehydration.
I mean, when you think in climate change in general, there could be a lot of little impact here and there. Having an increase in warmer days in the park could also go with having a little more days where we have to not allow any campfire for campers in the park, because it could be too dangerous as it's too dry. As this huge weather event seems to happen a little more now during our visitor season, we usually happen mostly over the winter when we don't offer as much service. But now that we are in full season with visitor, we have to make sure we have all we need to for evacuation, for informing our visitor for road closure, and all other things that might be impacted by weather events.
While our team was making this video, another storm swept through Cape Breton Highlands National Park. As a result of this storm, sections of the Cabot Trail at North Mountain were closed due to landslides and road washouts. Climate change drives some of the research undertaken by Parks Canada teams in their work to protect landscapes in Cape Breton Highlands National Park.
Well, I think you have to understand that climate change is what the word implies, that it's a change over time. And so if you have a people like the Mi'kmaq people who've been here for thousands of years and you know the landscape and know the environment, you can use that knowledge to act as a base, a foundation, and then you take the like two wide scene approach where you have the Western and you have the indigenous knowledge come together. And so working together, you're able to see, have a very accurate picture of what's happening to your environment.
Well, Parks Canada is doing, it's like applying a climate change lens, if you wish, to everything that we do now. It starts from, you know, on reducing our own greenhouse gas emission in our operations, to, you know, which is at the root cause of the problem. But we're also putting a lot of effort on adapting to climate change.
So the work that we do as a resource conservation team is twofold. We do lots of monitoring work to try to track changes in the ecosystem over time. So that includes things like water temperature monitoring and forest monitoring and breeding bird monitoring, all the different pieces of the ecosystem that fit together. And we also do lots of work with partners, researchers, and other organizations to try to improve our understanding of the ecosystem as it is right now. Things are going to change. You know, they always have and they always will. You know, climate change certainly is accelerating that and sending things in a direction that they might not have otherwise gone. So trying to understand as best we can what we have right now, we hope will help us predict how those changes are going to affect the ecosystem and its components in the future and help us make informed decisions about how to protect it going forward. Infrastructure renewal doesn't immediately seem like it's related to environmental integrity, but in fact it is, especially when it comes to fish, like migrating fish populations. So every time we get a chance to replace a culvert, we try to make it a culvert that is better able to allow fish to pass through. So replacing culverts, even though it seems like so distant from fish, is super important.
Every Canadian has an opportunity to do something, and just I think slowing down and listening to nature is one thing that all of us can do, because we seem to be in a hurry to get to nowhere fast. Parks Canada is a new place. We have new people, we have new ideas, we have a real appreciation how nature, how it behaves, how we behave around nature.
So you want to protect areas that need protection because you have to protect it for the next generations. They're not even here. So you have to protect it for the future.
My favorite thing to do at the park is doing camping. I like hiking with my brother, do sandcastle, and hearing the animals.
When we talk about climate change, it's really easy to go down a path of gloom and doom and think that this is all a foregone conclusion and there's no way that we can help anything. But I think we have to do our best to avoid that. You know, people are doing really incredible work to try to reverse the effects of climate change and mitigate the changes we've already seen. And I think we have to hold out hope that that's going to make a difference and it's going to mean something going forward. Additionally, I think we have to have a little bit of faith in the planet itself. You know, salmon, for example, have been around a very long time. The oldest salmon fossil is 50 million years old. So this species has seen changes before. They've survived them and, you know, they've been strong enough to stick around until now, which is incredible. In 50 million years, right? So rather than just assume that our efforts aren't going to mean anything and, you know, to lock the doors and go home, I think that we have an obligation to do the best we can to make it possible for salmon and the other species in the ecosystem to try to adapt going forward.
Since the establishment of Cape Breton Highlands National Park in 1936, it has been Parks Canada's mandate to preserve natural heritage, making it available to visitors, while promoting an awareness and appreciation of the natural world. To this day, we hope to encourage understanding of the forces that shape and change the landscapes here in the park.